alternative proteins. How will we eat in the future? From vegan meat alternatives to the use of technologies, such as precision fermentation and cell cultivation to produce food. That's what we're talking about.
Hello everyone, and here we are again together in the kitchen at Krones AG. I'm Micah, and I'm responsible for food technology.
And I'm Florian from Krones AG, and I'm responsible for sales of alternative beverages. And I'm Alex from Steinecker GmbH, and I'm responsible for engineering and designing the systems.
Right, last time we told you about the three different areas, that is plant proteins, fermentatively produced proteins, and cell cultivation. And today we want to go into a little more detail about plant proteins. We have prepared a short movie for you.
Pulses, whole grain products, nuts, seeds, and pseudo-cereals such as amaranth contain the most plant-based proteins. Lentils, beans, lupins, peas and chickpeas are therefore just as likely to be found on a vegan menu as soybeans and products made from them, such as tofu. For those who follow a vegan diet, animal welfare is the top priority. Alternative proteins form the basis for vegan drinks and foods as a substitute for animal products. The best known example is certainly plant-based drinks, which are simply mixed from grain, water and additives, such as oil.
That's right. Today we want to show you how to produce plant-based milk alternatives using the example of oat drink.
Alex, you were in New Zealand recently. Can you please explain to us exactly what happened there with our customers?
Yes, of course. I took a few photos or videos and can show you how the oat drink is made there. So, ultimately, we take oat grains and transport them to a mill in the first step to crush the oat grains. The crushed oat grain is then transferred to our mashing vessels, where it's mixed with water and enzymes are added. The enzymes then ensure that we dissolve the starch from the oats and hydrolyze it into various lengths of chained sugar. After this whole process, which takes about an hour, is complete, we then go and transfer this whole oat suspension into a decanter for solid liquid separation to obtain our oat base. And this is how the process works on an industrial scale in our plants. And we're going to recreate exactly what happens here in the kitchen.
Okay, what do we need? Well, you said water and oats. We have that here. What else do we need?
We need a pot and a blender to mix it all together, and finally our enzymes to break down all the oats, otherwise we'd have a dough and not an oat base. So, Flo, take the water and pour it in the pot. You're welcome, Alex.
So. The water is now about, yes, lukewarm in temperature, definitely not cold.
Exactly, it's already warm water. We then add the oat flakes in this case. On an industrial scale, we can also use whole grains or ready-made oatmeal. Here, for the sake of simplicity, we'll just use the rolled oats. And now we mix the whole thing together to make a porridge. That's roughly what it sounds like in the industry. Now, Micah, please add the enzymes.
All of it?
Yes, everything. And we can stop mixing the whole thing now. And now we put the whole thing on the stove. And heat it up for about an hour so that the enzymes can work properly and break down the starch. And this is basically how the process works on an industrial scale. And now we have to wait until it's ready.
Exactly. The enzymes have exactly two tasks in this case. On the one hand, they have to break it down to make it more viscous, that is, to make the whole mass more fluid. And on the other hand, to adjust the degree of sweetness. You know this from home. If you just put oat flakes in your mouth and chew them up, your own saliva does the same in your mouth, so that you have a sweet taste in your mouth afterwards. So now we're back here. We waited about an hour for the hydrolysis to finish. What do we do now?
So now we have to make sure that we separate the solid components from this suspension from the liquid components, that is, extract the liquid oat base. This is done on an industrial scale using a decanter centrifuge. Here we simply take the kitchen sieve and strain it.
Now, in principle, the insoluble components remain in the sieve, and what has been dissolved by the enzymes flows down into the beaker, and this is basically the finished base, which we can then use to make an oat drink.
So I think that's enough. We'll let that run out now. As you can see, it's relatively difficult to filter.
Aber zum zeigen.
And here we now have the oat base, which is now mixed with oil, additives and salts for the finished product, and adjusted with water to the final drinking strength, so that it can then be packaged and sold.
Exactly. You can always see that quite clearly. So if you go to the supermarket, you can see the variety of different oat drinks, whether for the coffee machine as a barista version with added calcium to get a little closer to milk. So there really is something for every taste. Let's give it a try.
Let's have a taste.
Yes, it tastes good.
Very good.
It's good. Yes, so as you've seen, it's not that difficult to make at home if you have the right utensils. In the next episode, we'll be talking to you about a topic of the future, namely fermentatively produced proteins. And we'd be delighted if you'd join us again.